So good evening once again. I, Ajay Jha, on behalf of American Chemical Society India team, welcome you to today's ACS Science Talk. And we are pleased to have Dr. Anirbhar Basu with us. So Dr. Basu is currently senior scientist at the National Brain Research Center, NBRC, Baneshwar, Gurgaon. He obtained his PhD from the Indian Institute of Chemical Biology, Kolkata. Thereafter, he did his postdoctoral research at the Pennsylvania State University College of Medicine, USA. Dr. Basu's research focuses on central nervous system diseases. He has a long list of awards and accolades to his credit. To mention a few, the National Bioscience Award for Career Development by Department of Biotechnology, DBT, DASI Reliance Industries Platinum Jubilee Award, Tata Innovation Fellowship, Department of Biotechnology, and the Fellowship of National Academy of Sciences, Indian Academy of Sciences, and Indian National Science Academy, and many more in the list. He also serves as the advisory board member of several journals and different publishing houses of international repute. So before Dr. Basu starts, a couple of instructions for the audiences. We request the audiences to put their questions into the Q&A tab, and please avoid putting questions in the chat box. In case of any internet issue, please stay with us. We'll be back soon. And with this, I would like to invite Dr. Basu to deliver his lecture. Over to Dr. Basu, please.
Okay. Thank you all. Thank you, Ajay, and thank you, entire ACS team, for giving this opportunity to me to share our work. And what I would like to discuss with all of you today, that we know that we are going through a pandemic. It's a viral pandemic. And my lab is interested in virus for a long time, almost last 16 years we are working. And I will put some point that see that how virus can spread and across the world, and how this re-emerging and emerging virus are so important. In this context, I will mention that drug repositioning and repurposing is so critical. All of you know from the newspaper and the press that we are trying to do several drug repurposing and repositioning even for the COVID-19. Several drugs in India they are trying to make, and across the world they are to do. But we are in this process for a long time, for last 15 to 16 years now. And the virus we are generally use in our lab is Japanese encephalitis virus, which is a common virus from the flavivirid group. Other virus in these groups are dengue and West Nile and some of the other like West Nile viruses. So you can see this virus outbreak happens across the world, like West Nile virus, then Zika, Ebola, JE, dengue, Nipah virus, and this chikungunya virus. And of course, all of you know about this corona and the COVID-19. The image I have here is a little bit older. It's when the just outbreak has started in China. So it's like, you can see here that only 6,000 patients at that point. So now you know the what is the number. But this figure is a bit old. It's like, I think January end, I was giving a talk at Kolkata. So that time I made that figure. But now all of you know that what is the number of this corona virus infected people across the world, and the number of deaths also there. So how this virus spread, Japanese encephalitis virus, it can spread from one continent to another continent very easily. And this review written by a very bright project assistant in my lab almost 12, 13 years back. And what we have showed there, that virus is capable to move from one continent to another continent very easily. Like more air travel is happening. And also like a vector biology itself is changing. And there is a global warming. As a result of global warming, the virus can spread one part to another part very easily. And this is one of the area you can see here. This is the JE virus endemic area, which is one of the world's most populated area. More than 3 billion people live here. And this area, it's easily possible from virus to move to one person to another person, very densely populated area. And this is the ecological cycle. This virus moves from bird to pig, and pig is an asymptomatic host. That's very interesting. Pig never shows any disease, but from pig, through a mosquito bite, virus can go to human, and human is a dead end host. From human, good part is that, unlike like coronavirus, it doesn't move from human to another human. So human is a dead end host. And this is a typical patient. You can see a 5-year-old girl, the dystonia, case of dystonia here. It's a neurological problem. So what happened in this cartoon, we can mention that this virus can infect neuron, and the result of that neuronal death happened. Due to the neuronal death, we can get the microglial cell activated. Microglial cells are nothing but the macrophage in the brain. And following activation, microglia can release different cytokine and chemokine, and there is again second bystander death happened, neuronal death happened. So it's a double problem. Virus can directly kill neuron, it's a neurotropic virus. On the other hand, following the death of the virus, microglial cell get activated because macrophage need to clean the debris of the cells. So basically microglia got activated to clean the dead neurons. But in this process, they are also activated and start releasing different cytokine, chemokine that are also responsible for neuronal death. In the animal, what we can see that following infection, there is a neuronal loss. So in the control animal, there are lots of neurons here and number of neurons are less in the 2-day post-infection, and in the 4-day post-infection, there are very less. This is the different types of activated microglia. You can see here, resting, activated, and phagocytic. And phagocytic microglia are responsible for releasing this cytokine, chemokine, and other factors like reactive oxygen species and nitric oxide. Almost 13-14 years back, a master student in my lab, Ayon Kochal, showed that in mice, pro-inflammation cytokines are there, very high level of pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha, interleukin-6, and MCP-1. Followed by that, we did a study with human patient, and this study done at Lucknow, SGPDI Lucknow with Dr. UK Mishra. There, what we have seen in the patient, there are infarct following GA infection. So this is the white patches at the infarct where dead neurons are there. Then we got CSF from this patient in our lab at NBRC Manesar and quantitated the different cytokines and chemokines. We have seen high level of RANTs, interleukin-6 and interleukin-8. So whatever we have found in animal is true in human also. Human also shows very high inflammation. And few years back, my postdoc in my lab, Navanita Sengupta, what she showed that in this CSF, very high level of interleukin-1 beta and TNF-alpha is also there. These two are very important pro-inflammatory cytokine. And another PhD student in my lab, Arshad Najmi, showed that if you have a autopsy brain tissue sample, which we got from Nimhan's brain bank from Bangalore, and showed that interferon response are also very significant in this autopsy brain tissue sample. And remember one thing, Nimhan's brain bank is the only one brain bank in this country, and they have this GE patient's autopsy brain tissue sample. So we actually isolate RNA from those tissue and seeing there is a significant amount of interferon alpha level, OSL1 and IFIT. All of them are interferon response element which are significantly upregulated following GE infection. Now I move to the second part of my talk. MicroRNA is very important in regulating disease condition as well as normal physiology. So before our study, no one knows how this microRNA regulates the inflammation process following GA infection. So we did an array, a postdoc in my lab, Maneka, did this array, and what she have found that in microglial cell following infection, there is a significant upregulation of different microRNAs like microRNA 29B, microRNA 155, microRNA 301A, and microRNA 301B. And she has shown again in that human autopsy brain tissue sample that microRNA 155 is very significantly expressed. So she also did in situ hybridization. There she has shown this presence of this microRNA 155 in this human brain autopsy sample. Then another postdoc in my lab, Vibhavashu Hajra, start working with this microRNA, microRNA 301A. And what he has found that in neuronal cells, microRNA expression is early. HT22, the neuronal cells, early. But in microglia, BV2, the expression of this 301A in data time point. So that's interesting because the same microRNA, they express in neuronal cells early, but they express in later time point in microglial cells. Based upon this work, what Bibhavarsu Hajra showed that microRNA 301A is a very important innate immune component there. So if you can block this microRNA 301, actually you can mediate the IRF1 mediated neuronal innate immune response in virus infection. And because this is the first time there is the evidence that neuronal cell plays a very important role in innate immune response. And that's one of the reasons we actually, when published this paper in Science Signaling, they decided to put this as a cover page image, because before this study, there are no study available which shows that neuron as a cell plays a very important role in innate immune response. And this is probably true for several other diseases we do not know at this stage. Bibhavarsu Hajra also showed this microRNA 301A also regulate the microglial function in the brain. And microglia, like a macrophage, there is the M1 profile and M2 profile. M1 profile is the inflammatory profile, M2 profile is the anti-inflammatory profile. What happened, if you can block this microRNA 301, it actually modulates the M1 microglia versus M2 microglia. So M2 microglia is now more in the systems and you get the less inflammation. So this microRNA 301A could be a good target. So one hand, you can actually blocking this, you can upregulate the innate immune response in the brain, neuronal innate immune response. On the other hand, you can dampen the microglial inflammatory response. So it has a dual effect. So now I move to the second part of my talk, that how, based upon this pathology, you can develop a drug. And it's a repositioning or repurposing. Normally, the new molecule journey from lab to drug at current prices for international market will cost $2.5 billion. Historically, repositioning and repurposing of old drugs has been proved successful in bringing new therapies to developing world. Earlier, we know in leishmaniasis, miltefosine is the one of choice of drug that is also a repurposed drug. So drug repurposing refers to the use of existing approved drugs for new indications, while repositioning involves the development of an existing previously evaluated but unapproved active pharmaceutical ingredient for the treatment of a different disease. So I will give you an example of repurposing first, then I'll give you an example of repositioning. This drug is known for a long time to the clinician. It's an antibiotic, it's a tetracycline, it's a neuroprotective effects are there in the stroke, Huntington disease, ALS, multiple sclerosis, Parkinson, traumatic brain injury, and diabetic retinopathy. And the mechanism of action is also known very well. It can block the caspase 1 and 3. It can also block the inorganic nitric oxide. And it can reduce the reactive microgliosis and also activation of P38 MAP kinase. So a PhD student in my lab almost 12-13 years back tried this experiment. What he has found, if you give the infection, viral infection, and if you start the drug administration next day, you can see there are 10% protection. That means minocycline able to protect almost all animals from the infection of Japanese encephalitis. But in ideal condition, patient won't come to the clinic next day. So what we did, we wait for a few days and symptom to appear, and then we start administering this drug. What we have found here, 70% animal gets protection. So even if we start the drug therapy process a little bit late and wait for the symptom to appear, in that case also, we have seen that 70% animal get protected. So that's actually very significant, because 70% animal get protected even if you start late. That's a good actually. So what is the mechanism for that? So we thought that minocycline working in two different ways. As it can, one hand, it can block the neuronal death because it can have the, it can block the caspase 1 and caspase 3. On the other hand, it also reduces the microgliosis, the microglial activation and the inflammation. So if one hand it can anti-apoptotic effect, so neuronal death has been stopped by administering this drug. On the other hand, if it reduces inflammation, that also helps in neuronal health, because you remember that microglia are also responsible for the bystander killing of the neuron. So if you can reduce the microglial activation, there are also high chances you can actually protect some neurons. So due to this dual protection effect, microglia is so, minocycline is so effective in this disease. But based upon this animal work, most of the study actually stopped in the animal studies. But what we did here, we actually moved one step further to did a clinical trial. And this clinical trial done at Lucknow, King George Medical University, it's one of the oldest medical universities in this country. And what we have done this trial, we take the GE patients and also some non-GE acute encephalitis. So there are also other virus, bacteria, fungi, they are responsible for the acute encephalitis. So we have taken the club of the disease, like an entire umbrella of the disease called the acute encephalitis. And it is done by my collaborator, Professor Reshmi Kumar there. It is funded by Department of Biotechnology. So briefly, we have taken 140 patients for this drug and 141 patients for the placebo. And I'm sure most of you know what is placebo. Basically, there is no drug, but it's the same composition, color composition, same type of composition. So you can inject both drug and placebo to the patient. Based upon the result, what we have seen that there is a trend towards higher survival in immunocycline in patients more than 12 years and trend towards better overall outcomes, which is Glasgow Outcome Scale immunocycline group. If early mortality is excluded, there is a significant benefit in both 3-month survival and overall outcome by Glasgow Outcome Scale. So exactly how minocycline is effective through its neuroprotective actions, antiviral antiapoptotic effect, or direct effect on host response, or a combination of these, it is still unclear. But the big thing is that this minocycline is working at least to some extent. And as of today, there is no therapy for acute encephalitis or Japanese encephalitis. So we have, this is the first time we have shown that there is a drug for this, and it's a repurposed drug, comparatively very cheap, no side effect, and it can be given to the any remote villages healthcare center. So there's a modest benefit and no specific treatment available. Given the magnitude of acute encephalitis syndrome in Indian subcontinent and probably in entire Southeast Asia, because as you remember my on the first slide, that GE is prevalent in China, Indonesia, Malaysia, Cambodia, Myanmar, or entire Southeast Asia. And when we did publish this trial, there is another group which is a completely separately did this study, and from the Gorakhpur Medical College, at very close to Lucknow, also in UP, they also showed that minocycline trial in Japanese encephalitis, a double blind randomized trial, they also showed some positive effect of this drug. So basically, this is a supportive to our study. Now I move to the last part of my talk, that I will talk about another virus, which is very common, dengue virus. So dengue, all of you know, actually dengue affect both platelet and macrophages cell. So what we have found that following infection, platelet release some factor. This is called platelet factor 4. But what I'm coming to here, that in the cultured human macrophage and monocyte, normal condition, if you see, it's the green dots at the dengue virus there. But if you put some active infected platelets there, the virus proliferations are more, all green dots are virus. And if you put some supernatant from this infected platelet, you also see virus proliferations are very high there. That means platelet release certain product, in the presence of that, more virus are proliferating in the monocyte macrophages. So what platelet is releasing? We have done a mass spec analysis, and we have found that this is the platelet factor 4, which has been released by the viral infection. And following the infection, this platelet factor 4 comes out of the platelet, and in the monocyte macrophage, the virus proliferation actually grows further when it comes in the contact of this platelet factor 4. And here, what we have showed that if you actually block this platelet factor 4, there is no viral proliferation at all. we did it with monoclonal antibody and another drug called AMG487. And I will talk about this drug, how it works. So basically here you can see normal condition. This is the no virus is there, but when you put the recombinant platelet factor 4, virus is growing inside the monocyte macrophage. And when you block it with a monoclonal antibody against platelet factor 4, again, no viral proliferation is there. And here also you can see that viral proliferation is there, but when you block this platelet factor 4 with a AMG487, which is the inhibitor of CXCR chemokine, and then you can see less viral proliferation there. And what is AMG487? AMG487 is a potent, so basically minocycline is a repurposed drug, because minocycline, there are other use and they are successfully used as an antibiotic, so it's a repurposed drug. Now, this one is a repositioning of a drug. AMG487 is a potent and selective orally bioactive chemokine receptor 3 antagonist. The compound was assessed for safety and pharmacokinetics in 30 healthy males in randomized double blind control. But what they have found that when they did this trial in psoriasis, it was not so successful and patients saw some symptoms, so the trial has been stopped. So basically now, if we can reposition this drug for new use, and I'm not going to this Western blot, but in the cartoon, what we have shown that normal condition, this platelet factor 4 binds with the CXCR3, which is the chemokine receptor 3, and you can get the down regulation of interferon alpha in the system. And if you get down regulation of interferon alpha, which is the protective, so you get more viral proliferation in the cell. But when you use this AMG487 and PF4 cannot bind with this CXCR3, then you get more interferon alpha. Actually, you get less viral proliferation in the cell. So that is the mechanism. That is the mechanism AMG487 is working. And when we studied the patient from All India Institute of Medical Science, Delhi, we have seen clearly that day 3, day 5, the amount of PF4 in that serum actually matches with the level of NS1. NS1 is the viral protein which you can see for the dengue viruses. So basically, the viral load in the patient matches very much with the level of their platelet factor 4 in the serum. So day 3 and day 5, here also day and day 3, 5 and day 5. So after that, platelet factor 4 actually getting down. Now amount is reducing. Again, the viral amount of virus also getting down in the human body. And this is the patient monocyte. You can see here in the day 3, 3 patients are here. They express the virus here, and this is here. And day 9, the number is amount of very less in this virus in these 3 patients. The day, patient 1, patient 2, patient 3, day 3, patient 1, patient 2, patient 3, day 9. So we repeat this, we try to work in the Japanese encephalitis. One of the reason is that dengue at that point, we do not have this animal model. So we try to use Japanese encephalitis model because we have a very reproducible animal model at our hand. So we tried this. And what we have found, same thing, when you have this recombinant platelet factor 4 in the system, human monocyte, virus is growing inside, Japanese encephalitis virus. But when you use the anti-PF4 antibody, then also see the number of virus proliferating inside are very less, very insignificant compared to this. And when you use this AMG487, again, we have found that very less virus. So AMG487 is working for dengue as well as Japanese encephalitis virus. But J is a neurotropic virus. So the brain monocyte macrophage lineage cell is microglia. So we tried same this in microglial cell, and we have seen virus normal condition is significantly growing in here when you add the recombinant PF4. But when you add the AMG487, hardly any viral proliferation is there. So now we move to the animal study. And animal, what we have found that this NS3 protein, which normally we see for Japanese encephalitis virus diagnostics, also NS3 protein. NS3 protein is very less when the group which got the AMG1. This is the two group which got the AMG. This is the two animals which got the AMG. but this is the JEE animal. So JEE animal NS3 is very high compared to this, and here also significantly high. This JEV1, JEV2, JEV3, these individual animals are there. They have a very high amount of NS3, and AMD is less here. So when the AMD treatment done, so there you can see the lesser amount of NS3. And interestingly, interferon alpha level also very high in this AMD1 group. So that's why animal probably getting some protection and less virus are growing inside cell, because interferon alpha level also very high. The two animals here and two animals here that show similar result here, because if you see that this is animal JV1, JV2, JV1, JV2, JV3, and here the AMD1, AMD2, and AMD1, AMD2. Similar result, which shows that in the animal which got the AMD treatment, they have a very significant amount of interferon alpha level. And 20% animal get protection out of it. So that's a good, because if you see that 20% animal getting full protection when you treat them with AMD1, and we measure the level of viral RNA in those animals and see in the spleen, liver, blood cells, and in the brain, the significant reduction in the viral titer here. And here in the all three survived animals. So we have seen the animal which actually survived, they have a very low significant reduction of the viral mRNA there. And in the cartoon, you can see here that normal condition, if PF4 binds with CXCR3, there's a significant upregulation of virus particle here. But when you block this with this CXCR3 antagonist, which is AMD487, then you can see very less amount of viral particle is going inside. Lastly, I will talk about only one slide here with another drug. It's also a repurposing drug, atorvastatin. I'm sure all of you know about the statin. It's a lipid-lowering drug. And a postdoc in my lab, Shubhadeep, few years back showed that statin is also a highly effective as an antiviral for two different virus, Japanese encephalitis virus and Chandipura virus. I'm not going to the details of the mechanism, but now into the mechanism also, there's a significant, at least 70% animal survived in both the cases. So when you treat the animal following infection with this atorvastatin also relatively, there is no side effect. So if you inject the animal after following infection, both Chandipura virus and JV, you can see there is a significant protection. So 70% animal actually protected. I think this is my last slide, and they are my students. So I'll be happy to take the questions I have done.